Okay, so in the chapter, it's advanced analysis of sampling arguments, because last week you did sort of analysis of sampling arguments, and this is more analysis of sampling arguments. But the real deal here is, although, you know, ostensibly we're doing this one thing, we did sampling arguments, and now we're doing model sampling arguments. This is supposed to be a springboard to analysis in general. Right, we're just going to try and learn how to do analysis. And the idea is we discuss argument analysis in the context of sampling arguments so that later we can do argument analysis in regarding other types of arguments. So the analysis, this is the analysis lecture. So it's sort of like, hey, we did some arguments that are fairly simple. Now we're going to do something more complicated with those arguments, so that later, when we do other kinds of arguments that are fairly simple, we can do that complicated thing. Now, I said before class, teaching is a communication issue. It's a communication problem. It's a matter of getting ideas across. And a great deal of my problem in figuring out how to teach this class is figuring out how to really get it across what's actually needed. Because what we do in logical analysis is very different from what most people do when they confront arguments. If you've ever watched any kind of political show, from the best to the worst, if you've watched anything, any of the commentators on Fox News or on NBC or Rachel Maddow or any political commentator, generally what they do when they're confronted with contrary information, the immediate reaction is to find some way of defending what they believe. And I saw this actually in an episode of the Rachel Maddow show. A legislator, a politician they were talking to, made a claim about Benghazi. And one of the reactions to this was to, instead of analyzing the claim and saying, okay, what's his evidence? Right, there was a Republican senator, a congressman, and he made a claim about Hillary Clinton and Benghazi, the State Department and Obama administration and Benghazi. And nobody asked what his evidence was. Nobody looked at that. Instead, one of the commentators sort of laughed at him and said, oh, that was shown to be completely wrong by this report. They said it was a religious report that said it, that threw it all over. Well, maybe there is a report that gives evidence that the Obama administration did nothing seriously wrong in handling Benghazi, or did nothing seriously wrong leading up to it. Maybe that's there. But in order to say that the other guy is wrong, you have to look at his arguments. So they didn't have time to really discuss this or let him make his case. But if you're going to say that somebody else is wrong, you have to say, what is his argument? What arguments has he given? What has he said in public to support this claim? What happens when you investigate his claims about Benghazi? What evidence did he give? And what did he say? And then when you find out what he says, you can think about it. But ignoring his argument and giving an argument of your own is not going to fully solve the problem. It's not going to knock down his argument. So to figure out if an argument's bad or good, we have to analyze it first. And so the first thing I want to do is talk about what I call a breakdown box. And a breakdown box is just, you just draw a square, a rectangle on a piece of paper, and make a smaller box at the bottom. You make a top, you make a big space at the top, a smaller space at the bottom. So the premises go here, and the conclusion goes here. Use the breakdown box for at least a couple of arguments, to do 3 or 4 or 5 arguments in the breakdown box, so you get used to breaking apart arguments apart in this way. So it's a matter of clarification. I remember reading a story a long time ago about the head of British Mensa, the high IQ social club. And obviously this guy is not really typical of Mensans. People in Mensa are not. This is why these are rubbishy videos. I go and get coffee. I've got my cup. So this is the head of, he's the head of Mensa in Great Britain. And he got into an argument with his next door neighbors. A very, very acrimonious, loud argument, and there was ill feeling for a long period of time. And then one day, the neighbors turned up sick. And they turned up sick in a very peculiar way. And the police came, the police were called, because this was really weird. They went to the hospital, and the people in the hospital said, "Never seen this before." And they worked out. And they worked out that they'd been contaminated with something called thallium, which I'm not really sure if it's an element or a chemical or stuff, but it's something that's poisonous, and it had obviously made them sick. And then they said, "Well, is there anyone who doesn't like you?" And they said, "Yeah, our neighbor hates us." So they started looking at the neighbor, and they found that, I think in a newsletter, a Mensa publication, he said, he wrote something, you know, people better be careful. They shouldn't attack people, others, when they leave their doors and windows open and their food is exposed. Then they go, so the police go to the fellow's house and say, "Can we have a look around?" And he says, "Sure, I've got nothing to hide." And they go into his garage, and there's a bottle of thallium in his garage. And so it becomes blindingly obvious what he'd done. And he was the head of Mensa. That's incredibly embarrassing to Mensa, who whose membership is largely not composed of psychotic and incompetent would-be murderers. I'm not sure what happened to him, whether he went to jail or they locked him up in a loony bin. So I concocted this weird argument here, right, that says, look, the most intelligent among us are always the worst among us. Nobody actually argues this, I just made this up. The most intelligent among us are also always the worst among us. That Mensa member tried to murder the people next door with thallium and wrote snotty articles about it in the Mensa newsletter. So all smart people are evil. So that's presented as an argument. There's something I'm saying, and I'm giving a reason to believe it. So I want to talk about how we analyze that. So what's the conclusion there?
That all smart people are evil.
Yeah, all smart people are evil. Right, I'm going to put it down there. So that's what I would write here. And I'm trying to change the way I phrase things in these, you know, to use synonyms and things to try and paraphrase as much as possible. Because the more I paraphrase, the more I make it my own. And the more I get it clear. And there's always a danger in paraphrasing, because sometimes, have you ever had someone tell you what you just said and got it wrong? Yeah. In fact, there are people who do that. There seem to be people who do that deliberately. I've had long conversations with people where I'd say something to them, and they say, but Yos, you can't say blah, blah, blah. I say, well, I didn't say that. I said this. And it gets worse from there. And after a while, it's like, well, you know, this person's never actually going to listen. You have to move on. So the basic technique. So you have to be very careful about how you paraphrase. Right? You want to make sure you don't get what they're saying wrong. Just make sure you don't change it. But you have to paraphrase because you have to make sure that you actually understand what they're saying. I actually won an argument with someone just by clarifying what he was saying. It was on one of those Facebook things. And he was saying certain things of that, oh, this is what the government's doing is horribly wrong. And I said, okay, what are you saying exactly? And over several exchanges, I narrowed down what he was saying. So you're saying this. He said, yes, I'm saying this. And it was basically about property rights. Taxation is bad. Okay, so, and then I said, okay, so the next thing is, what's your argument for the existence of property rights? And he said, well, let's start with natural law, because that's the least controversial. I said, okay, well, I know quite a lot about physics, and I don't see any way physics, which is natural law, makes property rights. Never heard from him again. It was great. But you want to paraphrase, you want to make sure to when you're arguing with someone, if you're having an argument that you're interested in, make sure you know what they're saying. And ask them, are you saying this or this? Right? You really want to get it clear what the other person is saying, because otherwise, you know, you can go wrong and you could be off topic. So, right. So the first thing for premises, fill this in, is look at all the things that have been said. And if you just write in what they said, pretty much the way they said it, that's a good start. I'm going to use a kind of shorthand. All right, so the first thing they said was most intelligent, the worst of us. To be precise, because I'm actually only talking about one person. And you can see this is actually a terrible argument. It's a horrible, horrible argument. It makes no sense. It's not good at all. And then the last thing is, so there's three things I think that is, does the, in looking at the argument, did you see anything else that should be in there? Right? Because when you're doing the first breakdown box, you try to, try to include all details, whether they seem relevant to you or not. Oh, I did leave something out. What did I leave out? The thallium, yeah. We divide, I mentioned something. Now, this detail about Thalia may or may not be relevant. It may be completely irrelevant, or it might count. So when you're doing the first breakdown, you, especially when you're starting out and learning this technique, you include everything. And you want to translate this into putting an argument in standard form. Now, here's a step of analysis that's sort of optional, but it's good if you can do it. This is something you can do when you first laid it out, when you've got the argument there. You look back at this box and try and think about what you should cross out. And it's okay if you skip this step, because you can do this, the logical part again later. When you're analyzing an argument, it's a good idea to periodically step back and say, am I getting this right? Right, to go and say, hey, did I screw up here? To do what I call error checking, so that you think, ah, I got this, this is good. Well, maybe it's not good. What did I leave out? What did I leave out? Did I include something that I shouldn't? Well, when people are making arguments, especially me, I do this, I try to do this. When I'm making an argument to someone, I'm making a claim, and I'm supporting with reasons, I'll discuss the reasons, and I'll repeat the conclusion two or three times so that people know what I'm saying. You see, I repeat myself a lot. That's a communication tool. So if you have a main point and you repeat your main point three or four or five times, that increases the chance that your audience will know your main point. Have you ever had this where you explain something to someone and they've missed the most important thing? Sometimes they do that deliberately, sometimes they're just not carefully listening. So if you say it three or four times along that, and they miss it then, you say, look, you're not listening. I said three, four times, blah, blah, blah. That's my point. You know what my point is? Yeah. So, did I repeat myself here? Is there anything in the premises that is just another statement of the conclusion? Well, take a look at this.
The first one.
Right. So I would cross this out. This is just another way of saying the conclusion. It's not really an argument. Now, there are people who make arguments just by repeating the same thing in different words, but that's never works. It's not logical. It's a rhetorical trick. It's perfectly fine, but it's not logical. All right, so from that, you would go to try to put an argument in standard form. And one way to think about it is to think about it as just simply erasing the outside line. Because a standard form argument looks like this. Did I put British in there? No, I'm not going to. Hi, just come on in. So, and again, I'm trying to phrase it differently as I can. Trying to improve my phrasing as I go along. By the way, there's a simple technique that can improve your writing for any class. And here's how it goes. You always need to write ahead, right? So you write your paper, so you've got a finished draft, what you would normally the kind of draft you would normally turn in. You've got a full finished draft 3 or 4 days or a week before the paper's due. So you work way ahead. Then you wait a day. You finish the paper, you go off and you do other stuff. And you come back and you come back and you sit down and you try to write your paper again from memory. So you keep the file closed, you maybe do it on paper and pencil or pen or at least start a new blank document. And you start a new blank document and you try to write your paper again from memory. If you get stuck with remembering stuff, you can peek at your notes or peek at the text, peek at the materials you used to write the original paper. But don't look at the paper you wrote. Write a whole new paper where you're attempting to say exactly the same things. Not in the same words. You don't try to remember the words you used. You make up words as you go along. When I do these lectures, I don't have notes. I figure out what I'm going to say as I'm going. This for classes that I've taught 4 or 5 times before, I know what I'm going to say, but I don't figure out how I'm going to say it until I'm up in front of the class. And so every lecture I do is going to be different. It's the way I feel like explaining it at the time. And I think that as I do this, I get better and better because I notice I make some mistakes and I try to avoid those in the next iteration. So when you've done this new version of the paper, this new draft of the paper, where you did not at all look at the old draft, and you did it a day later, then you take the two papers, right? And you'll notice that generally the second one will be better. It will be better phrased, you'll be made yourself more clear, it might be a little better organized. So you keep that draft and whatever's good about it, but then you look at the other one, is there something that you did better in the previous one? Will you incorporate that? So you take these two drafts and take the best bits, the best parts of both. Right, for every point, right, go by point thing you're saying, take the best phrasing of that point, the best organization, you combine that. And you find you've improved your paper without a huge amount of effort. Because part of it is you let your subconscious work on the issue. It's always better to give yourself a couple of ideas, a couple of hours or a day between work sessions on any particular topic, because you struggle and struggle and struggle with something, and then you go away and relax or do something else, and that bubbles up. The good ideas bubble up. And that's the same thing with doing arguments. If you can like recreate the argument from memory, right, you put this away, and then write it out in standard form from memory, that's a lot better than doing it by having it open and then working on it back and forth. Because then it goes deeper into your mind and you've got a bit deeper understanding of it. You can't always do that, but I recommend doing it a lot while you're first learning logic, because that sort of trains your brain. So, which I just put, that's just the same phrasing as before. I just couldn't think of any other way of saying it. But when you're doing analysis, I guess that's okay. Okay, so that's that technique. Any questions? So that should be pretty clear. So, all right, now, and there's another example in the text of the Muslims and things like that, and I hope you all read that and practiced that. The idea is you take, when you practice this, at a certain point you get where you can take a very, very complicated argument and and make it simple, make it a point by point by point thing so that you know exactly what the person is saying. And analysis is time consuming, because I know that when I read articles on the internet, magazine articles and things like that where someone's arguing something, it often takes me quite a while to figure out exactly what they're really saying. Especially if they use emotional language, but even if they're being perfectly calm, I'll miss stuff on the first reading. I'll go, you're saying, no, they're saying something weird, and then I go back and look at the article and say, oh no, that isn't weird. And here's one technique you can use, is you read the article and paraphrase it, and then look at it and say, are they saying, in your version, you look at what you've written and say, is any of that weird? Is any of that wrong? And when you find stuff that seems to you to be wrong, go back to the original article and see if they're actually saying that. Sometimes they're actually saying it, but other times, sometimes you will have made a mistake. You didn't read it quite right. So you go back to the article and you change your paraphrase based on what they actually said. So, now I'm going to talk about abstraction. Abstraction is probably the most crucial skill in critical thinking. It's the skill that allows us to go from speeches, ordinary language speeches, stuff people say, stuff people write, to logical principles. And so it's a very, very important skill, and it's hard to learn. People have a hard time learning it. So I try to do a lot of abstraction, simple abstraction exercises in the class. But it's a matter of trying to be, if you can do abstraction, and it's a skill anyone can learn, when you've mastered the art of abstraction, then you can see into the logical motor of an argument. You can see how it is really supposed to work. And once you're able to abstract that, a lot of stuff becomes very, very much more clear. And I've noticed this with students, that sometimes you can see them not understanding stuff, and then when they learn how to do abstractions, suddenly they understand it. Oh, this is what the person is saying. Because when we first read something that people only have, and I had and I don't think this is properly taught everywhere in schools, because I did have a student who told me that when he was in English class and he was being taught how to understand paragraphs, he said, well, the teacher said, well, read it over and then figure out what you feel the writer is trying to say. Which is not the right way to do it. That's what people actually do, but it's not what we should do. What we should do is you read the first word, then the second word, then the third word, until you get to the period. Then you look at the structure of the sentence and how the words are arranged relative to each other, and you figure out what that sentence actually says. You don't try to form a general impression. You try to put aside your general impression and look at what the person actually says. And I think a huge part of why some people do badly at school is that they're not taught to read. They're not taught to read carefully to see what people are, what the textbook is actually saying. And I've had people tell me that textbook said the opposite of what it says because they didn't read, and they didn't think that they had to read. So you've got to watch, you've got to be able to read carefully. Now the abstraction part of this is you go from you take the statement and then remove concrete details. Now, when you're doing argument analysis to figure out whether an argument's good or bad, the concrete details, the details of the argument, are crucial. There will be certain details in it. The only way to tell whether a particular argument is good or bad is to look at the details. But when we're but we also have to look at logical principles. And one of the ways to understand logical principles is as abstractions. So to figure out what kind of argument is being made, we have to do an abstraction. So, all right, so think about what the words mean. Well, Mensen is a particular kind of clever person, right? So I'm going to drop out the detail that it's a Mensen and just put, I'm going to make it try and make this more general. All right, so Mensens are people with high IQs. High IQ person tried to kill. So his neighbors, that's kind of a concrete detail. I mean, if we had their names and addresses, it'd be even more concrete. But neighbors, so I'm just going to put some people. Now, notice that this, as it's becoming abstract, it's also becoming more vague. You know, a high IQ person tried to kill some people is more vague than a Mensen tried to kill his neighbors. If we put in his name and address and their names and address, that'd be even more concrete. Poisoning is less concrete than poisoning with thallium, so I can vague it up there. So that's a little more vague and it's a little more abstract. It's less useful in some ways, but it is useful in sort of getting across the idea of abstraction. So, and I could maybe turn that into smart people. Right, now I'm going to make it even more abstract. A person of a particular kind, right? High people with high IQs are a group inside the general population. Not everybody has a high IQ, so they're a small group. So I'm saying a person of a particular kind tried to do something right. Not going to say it's killing, break it down, but now I have to in the abstraction make the rest of the sentence fit. So a person of a particular kind tried to do something. So all people of that kind are also the kind of people who want to do the kind of thing he did. Now, what I'm going to tell you is like this. This is about one particular incident, and it's one about one particular argument saying, look, that particular person with these features, that Mensen, person with a high IQ, a member of Mensa, tried to kill the specific people who live next door to him, so all smart people are evil. This, maybe if this is more vague and more general, but it covers more possible arguments. Maybe there's another high IQ person who tried to kill some other people with a different kind of poisoning. Right. So there's more possible arguments that will fit this. Here, there's tons of arguments that would fit this. Right. Anytime someone says, this person who's that of this kind, this person is this type of person, he did this kind of thing, so all people of his kind do that kind of stuff. So what does it fit? It fits any argument based on a stereotype. Right? A black person stole something, so all black people are thieves. A Jewish person cheated someone, so all Jewish people are cheats. So every time you've got an argument that takes a certain kind of behavior by one person and generalizes it to all people of a group that he can be identified with, is that kind of argument, and it fits this. Right? But we can make it even more abstract. So, I'm going to go back to black. A member of group X did Y, so all members of group X do Y. So it says what, but member of the group could be an object now. We're no longer necessarily talking about persons. Now we have a completely abstract form. And this form actually has a name. There's actually a name for this way of using. It's not, I didn't put it in the text, but I can put it in here. It's a sweeping generalization based on a single anecdote. This is the way I made the argument. I said, hey, there's this anecdote. And this anecdote is true, at least according to the British newspaper that I read. Right, so let's say it's a true story. I talk about one member of Mensa who did one evil thing. And then I generalize, say, all smart people are evil. Well, once you abstract that, you see that it has this particular form that has this name. And we give this name to it. It's an anecdote. It's a sweeping generalization. I'm saying something of all smart people. And it has this form, sweeping generalization based on a single anecdote. Well, now that you've seen this abstraction, you can look at any argument and tell whether or not it fits this logical form. That's the name for this kind of thing here, is it's a logical form. Right. If you see someone is generalizing from a single anecdote, and once you've analyzed this argument, and you say, well, that's ridiculous. It could be completely coincidence that he was a smart person who did this. Right? Once you see this, you see that that argument doesn't work. Right? You can also see that the reason it doesn't work is because this form is bad. One member of a group did something, so all members of the group do that kind of thing, or are the kind of object that is likely to do that thing. That just doesn't follow. So if you run into another argument that has the same form, you see the form and you say, okay, I see what you're doing here. I can abstract out the details and look at the logical form. And this is what I mean by looking deeper. You're looking into the nature of the argument and figuring out how it works and whether it works or not. So again, I've got some examples in the text where you do this. So now, one of the good things about breaking down arguments and about abstraction is you can do it anytime. It's something that's a very basic skill that you can learn right away, that you can apply to arguments, and it gives you practice and attention to detail, and doing the abstraction gives you practice in thinking about logical form. And so you can sort of teach yourself logic from the bottom up. If you take this out of the class, if say, you know, in a logic class you learn certain things, but you don't learn everything. But you go on practicing this, and you practice it in your daily life, in dealing with other people, in dealing with arguments you get from the TV or the World Wide Web, arguments from other people, and abstract, do the abstraction, do the breakdown box. That gives you, when you've taken the the specific argument and turned it into an abstraction, and you look at that rule and you say, does that rule work? Is that a good rule? And if it's not a good rule, that's not a good argument. Right, so, so this leads into the discussion of what I call argument form. Which can also be called a strategy. I like to use the word strategy. I use the word strategy to describe how a particular argument is supposed to work. What way, general way of working is being used. And the first form I'm going to talk about is this is something you guys should be familiar with, right? Because we just covered it on Tuesday. It's the general form of a sampling argument. Okay. So if you read an argument, if someone's making an argument in an article and they refer to a sample or some way to refer to a small group taken from a larger population, you know they're talking about a sampling argument. And you have to evaluate it the way sampling arguments are made. Or if someone makes a general statement, somebody says that all of something have a feature. People make generalizations all the time, and they often don't support them at all. Or they support them by saying somebody else says this. Well, if someone's made a generalization, you're always entitled to ask, what sample is this based on? How big was it? How was it taken? When was it taken? And you can ask, and lots and lots of data turns out to be very, very soft. There was a claim that 40% of sales. Gun sales in the United States are done without background checks, are unregulated. And I was believing this for a while, and then I started to ask, well, where did the figure come from? Well, the figure wasn't 40%, it was something like 35%. And it came from a newspaper article of someone who I think they did a phone survey. And the question that they asked was, they asked, have you bought a gun in the last year? And then if they said they had bought a gun, and said, did the dealer do a background check? Well, the problem is people forget stuff. And the dealer does the background check, not the buyer. So it's possible for the dealer to do a background check and the buyer doesn't know. And so I looked at this and like, that's a very sloppy survey, and it's bad. The numbers are soft. I don't trust that. And I don't trust the people who are saying, who are taking it, adding a few percentage points, you know, exaggerating the numbers, and using it for political capital. So I don't trust that, because I found out how the numbers were generated. My girlfriend teaches sociology, and she tries very hard to use textbooks with up-to-date information. But when she looks through the textbooks, and they say, oh, census data, up-to-date stuff, she looks at some of the most crucial figures are 20-year-old data, 30-year-old data. I mean, next time you take a social class or a class, a social studies-related class, and they talk about how many, what percentage of the current United States population has a certain feature, look, follow the footnotes, find the date, the article that's being cited, and find when it was written. If it was written in 1972, that's 40-year-old data. The United States has changed tremendously in the last 20 years. What if the survey data is people's attitudes towards gay marriage?
Boy, that would be old.
That would be so, so old. There's been such a huge transformation in the attitude of the American people, particularly young people, towards gay marriage. You know, the current generation, people in the late teens and early 20s, are firmly in favor of gay marriage. They regard the idea, the opposition to it as ridiculous. Maybe not the majority in Oklahoma, but in California, it's an incredible balance. California gay marriage is going to be a feature of California. So there's that sort of thing there. And this is what I mean is strategic analysis, is when you look at an argument and figure out how it's supposed to work. I'm going to put that in here. Do the abstraction, abstract the argument. I like to call it the logical motor. Technically, it's logical form or argument form. Once you know the logical form, you can tell if it's good or bad. Okay. And the one thing we can be sure about this is bad form implies bad argument. If an argument has a good logical form, or a logical form that's not necessarily bad, it might be a good argument. It might still be a bad argument, but there's always that possibility. But if it has a bad form, then it's definitely a bad argument. So here's the form for sampling arguments. We know some sampling arguments are good and some are bad. So this is a form that can work. You don't look at it and say that'll never work. But you can't look at it and say it always works, because you've got to add factor in the factual claims and the way that you know. So this is a form that can work. To tell whether or not a specific argument is working, you have to look at the concrete details. One thing you do when you look at an argument is look at the argument form. If it's an argument form that can work, okay, maybe this argument is good. Here's another argument form. I left something out. Pop is short for population. One member of a large and varied population has a feature, so all members of that population have the feature. Human beings are very variable. If one human being, intelligent people are very variable, or people with high IQs. People with high IQs are not necessarily intelligent, but high IQ people are very variable, so making a generalization based on just one of them is stupid, never works. I had to put in the thing about varied population because you can, a very, very small sample, in fact, one individual. If you know that everything in the box is identical, you only have to look at one. Right? And so I think that all hydrogen atoms have the same atomic number. So how many hydrogen atoms do you have to look at to tell what the atomic number is? You have one. This is something that very rarely happens, right? You very rarely can tell anything about a population from one member, but sometimes you can. Right, so there's another argument form that's not good. A popular argument form. Person. He said statement S, so S is true. This is an authority argument. That's it, because authority arguments is sometimes. And these are the type of argument that sometimes works and sometimes doesn't. Sometimes somebody saying something is good, gives you good reason for believing it's true. Sometimes it's not good reason. Generally speaking, we think that if somebody says something, it's true unless we have reason to think otherwise. But I mean, if strangers tell me things, I'm skeptical of that. For a start, you're a stranger. Why are you telling me stuff? Can you give an example of someone who we routinely don't trust?
The media.
Say
again? The
media. The media. Actually, that's somebody we should routinely is generally right. The news media gets stuff right much more often than some other groups that we could think about. What about politicians, for instance? Mm-hmm. Salespeople. Should we trust salespeople?
No.
Never. Never. It's very. You have to be very careful about trusting salespeople. Um, I don't fully trust any politician, not since Paul Wellstone died, but there are some politicians I trust a lot more than others. Bernie Sanders, I trust quite implicitly. Chris Christie, on the other hand, or Rand Paul, if someone tells me this is true because Chris Christie said it, I'm going to say, well, Chris Christie has said so many things that are not true, that are demonstrably not true, that I would not pay any attention to him. And similarly, Rand Paul's an imbecile. Why would I pay attention to him? So if you're talking about a politician, you better talk about someone who has a very good track record. Otherwise, I'm going to just say the fact that he says it doesn't make it true. I want some independent corroboration before I'll take that seriously. Lawyers are very practiced liars. I would never trust something that was said to me by a lawyer. They're often very good at telling lies in such a way that you can't actually prove that they were lying when they said it. That doesn't make them honest, it just makes them clever. So, there's other argument forms that are... I'm going to put in another... two more argument forms that are bad, that I should have mentioned before, I think. And they're bad in two different ways. Right. Sort of the most basic kind of argument form that I could put up here is A is true, so B is true.
Can you read the red? There's a good glare.
There's a deer, so we can't maybe.
Oh,
the light's clearing.
A is true and has nothing to do with B, so B is true.
Thank you.
Now that's putting the parenthesis is added to, because you have a basic form of any argument, A is true, something is true, so something else is true. Every argument has this form. Something is true, so something is true. And so you have to sort of break, you have to add in a little more detail to be able to tell the difference between a good form and a bad form. And here's an example of a bad form. A is true. This thing is true. What he doesn't mention is that this has nothing to do with B. They're not logically connected. So B is true. And that's the argument of red herring, the fallacy of red herring. Have you ever had a conversation with someone, and you're arguing one side, they're arguing the other, and then they say something that has nothing to do with the topic, but they think it makes them right? Yes, but what about this? Well, what about it? It has nothing to do with the subject. So they're changing the subject. Particularly when someone's done something wrong and you're pressing them on it and trying to get them to admit, to acknowledge they did something wrong and to maybe fix it. And they'll try and change the subject. And that's called red herring. And it's a very common fallacy that is talk about something that has nothing to do with the subject. So in order to, you know, in order to tell, to identify a real instance of red herring, you have to be able to see, you have to look at something. Well, remember the irrelevant comments. So it's like, that material from the Earth's core is a billion years old, so it can't be a good sample. Mm-hmm. Well, that doesn't matter, it's a red herring. Because in this particular situation, nothing changes into that under earthly conditions. Right? You need the heat of and pressure of a star to change one element into another. To turn something into nickel iron. So that's a red herring. Now, they're talking about something that sounds relevant, feels relevant, but really isn't relevant. P is true, so P is true. Now, this is clearly a bad argument. Because if we already agree that P is true, we don't need to be convinced that P is true. And an argument is an attempt to persuade. So the A is something that we accept, and then A is supposed to be something we accept, or which we can be persuaded to accept, that supports the claim that B is true. And so in this first fallacy, A does not support B, right? We talked about logical support in the basics chapter, right? So where A does not support B at all, the fallacy is red herring. Where A supports B because A is B, the fallacy is something called begging the question. Which means you're saying that P is true because P is true. Okay, what's your evidence that that's true? Have you ever had a conversation like that? It doesn't happen very often directly, but they'll say, you ask them somebody why they believe something or why you should believe some particular thing, and they say basically the same thing, just in different words. I can say, well, I'm asking you why that's true. There's this doctrine in philosophy called psychological egoism, that people who believe that everybody is selfish. And I have sometimes students write on it, and some of these students write, well, basically everybody is selfish because everybody is only looking out for their own self-interest. And I ask, well, can you prove that everybody is only looking out for their self-interest? And they say, sure, because whenever somebody makes a decision, the only thing they ever think about is their own self-interest. Yeah, can you prove that? And sometimes they get really, really upset that I don't just take their word for it. And I say, you haven't given me a reason to think psychologicalism is true. And they'll say, yes, I have. Look, here's the reason. And it's another way of saying, psychological egoism is true, because it's true. So when you're dealing with someone like that, it's often very hard to get across to them that they actually need a reason that's different from their conclusion. So you see this kind of argument. Right? And begging the question also applies when the basic thing about begging the question is give you an A that implies B, but the A is just as controversial as the conclusion. So the premise as B. So those are two clearly bad forms, and these are actually very basic, the two most basic errors you can make, talking about something that doesn't matter, and assuming that your conclusion is true, or assuming that, say, you've proved stuff that you actually had to prove. So I'm going to quit now for 15 minutes.